the city farm. Molly was terribly excited. She eagerly sat at the front window all morning, waiting for the big moving truck to arrive with Poppy and all his things. He was coming to live with them, and Molly wondered if he was bringing everything from the farm to their house in the city. She giggled as she thought about his sheep baaing and running up and down the hallway, and his proud rooster chasing her cat all over the backyard. And she really did hope that gentle Clancy, his old stock horse, was coming. He could stay in her room. But when Poppy finally arrived, he wasn't in a moving truck at all. He was driving his own old white rusty ute with a few boxes on the back. She eagerly showed him his room and helped him put away his few things, but Molly could tell straight away that Poppy was different in the city. He never wanted to come in the backyard with her, and he hardly ever left his room, which was strange because Molly could only ever remember seeing him outside in the paddocks or tinkering away in the shed back on the farm. He must have been missing Clancy and the sheep and probably the rooster too, she decided. And so she started making him a surprise. She heaved out all the spare bits of timber from Dad's tool shed and started building them up into tall, thin piles to make fences in the backyard. Then she tied string into a few clever knots Poppy had showed her once to make moving wood gates, and she made sure there was an extra tall fence in the back corner for Clancy. When she was done, she stood back to admire her work. Not bad, a bit rickety, but it would do for now, and she excitedly ran to Poppy's room to tell him the good news. "Come on, Poppy, come and see," she called, dragging his arm down the dark hallway and into the bright, sunny backyard, proudly showing him all the pens. "Now you can go and get Clancy and the sheep," she cried triumphantly. "Oh, love," Poppy sighed. "I don't think they'd like the city very much. Too many houses, too many cars, and way too many people." "The city's no place for a farm, Molly," he said sadly, trying to sneak back inside the house. But Molly wasn't giving up. "Come on, Poppy, let's try anyway, just for fun," which is what her dad always said to her when she thought something was too hard to try. The old man looked down into his granddaughter's big, hopeful eyes. Then he scratched his head, and then he looked around the backyard. "Well, I guess all we really need to make a farm is a bit of dirt, good sun, and enough water. All right, Molly, let's give it a go, just for fun." And that's how Molly became Poppy's number one farmhand. First, they set to work collecting all the timber and getting the chicken house started. Next, they dug up big chunks of lawn to plant out their first crops. And then, after a quick trip to the hardware store, with hammer and nail in hand, they put up the new rain gauge on the back fence. "Every farmer needs to watch the rain. No life without water," Poppy said. And Molly loved racing out after a big downpour to see just how much rain they caught. Some days they walked to the big community gardens, not far away, to collect seeds and swap their eggs for cuttings. On rainy afternoons, they fired up the old ute and visited the local library to look through books on growing veggies and keeping chooks in small spaces. They learnt that tomatoes grow best with basil plants dancing at their feet, and beans, squash and corn make a great growing team. And they were delighted when the Muscovy ducks Molly finally convinced Poppy to get gobbled up all the critters making holes in their kale and cabbage leaves. Each season they tried different crops and different combinations, and with every little success, Molly noticed that Poppy's smile was starting to grow back. The harvests also grew bigger and bigger until the day came when they were growing more food than they knew what to do with. So they put up a little sign in the front yard, and Molly painted bright red letters with Poppy's help that said, "Molly and Poppy's City Farm." And underneath it, they built a small wooden shelf for all their extra fruits and veggies and eggs, and they left a tin with a slot in the top for the money to go in. People stopped by all the time for food and for a chat about the farm, about the weather, and sometimes they even came in to help work. Molly had no idea so many nice people lived on her street. Occasionally, some of the neighbours complained when a pumpkin vine crept over the fence or when the muscovies escaped next door and made a mess of the roses. But it was nothing that a box of veggies or a few jars of preserved lemons couldn't fix, and soon the whole neighbourhood was stopping by regularly. They wanted to join the city farm too. "Great," said Poppy, and the farm began to grow. Mrs. Aldecott's garden became the orchard, and the muscovies moved in permanently, quacking their way up and down the rows of fruit trees, gobbling up the grubs. The Benson family had the perfect setup for the brooder houses, and the children were particularly good at caring for the baby chicks and any unwell chickens. And Mr. Martinello's huge backyard was perfect for their bigger crops, with all that healthy soil and sunshine flooding in. Their first big harvest from there was the wheat crop, and Molly noticed how gigantic Poppy's smile grew the day everyone came together not long after for their first threshing, winnowing, and grinding party, where everyone got to take home a party bag filled to the brim with fresh, stone-ground city farm flour. And the farm continued to grow, so big that it could feed everyone now, as well as keep the new City Farm shop inside the Davidson's spare front room full to bursting with produce and customers lining up out the door. People came from near and far, from all over the city, and even from other cities, asking Molly and Poppy all about the City Farm, and even how they might be able to set one up themselves. And when they asked them what was the first thing they grew on the farm, Poppy always smiled and looked at Molly before answering, "Hope." You see, all you really need to set up a farm is a bit of dirt, good sun, enough water, and hope. Lots of hope.